So, ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to welcome Joe Justice, our keynote speaker, for the second day of our conference. I first heard Joe speaking 10 years ago when he gave a keynote about his company Wikispeed at a Scrum gathering. That was like ages ago. And since then, he's worked with Bill Gates and the leadership team of Amazon, and he operated the Agile program at Tesla for Elon Musk. And today he'll give us insights how Tesla works in terms of management, budgeting, internal processes, and execution, and how all these aspects turn into rapid innovation. And like, there's one special secret I didn't know. Joe just told me that right now is his honeymoon morning because he got married yesterday. So it is, what time is it now in Kansas?
It's 7 a.m. here.
7 a.m. So, Joe, thank you so much for spending your honeymoon morning with us for an hour. And it's a pleasure. The stage is yours.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sebastian. Everyone, my apologies for my voice. I did party yesterday for the wedding, but I'll try to do my best. I'll try to be clear. Hopefully you can see some slides I'd like to share, some images. When I was working in Tesla, I created an Agile hardware development program to help clarify the Agile processes used in Tesla. And it's a 12-step program that is made to reinforce what Tesla's culture is. And now I have permission to share it publicly. And I do now teach this as a public class for companies who are moving from hardware development to agile hardware development, trying to get some of the innovation gains that Tesla has experienced. The way we make work visible is not with a very complicated chart. We simply use a Kanban of what steps are next. And often there's only a doing column. Very often there's only a doing column because what comes next emerges so quickly. In the course, the first thing we practice is how Tesla launches teams. And I'd like to show that with you right now. When I joined Tesla, the total onboarding for new employees was only 4 hours. There were nearly 100,000 employees establishing the culture. Until nearly 100% of headcount is operating in an agile way, you may need 2 to 10 days of training and follow-up coaching for all staff to maintain agility. In my onboarding, we read the anti-handbook handbook. Those 4 pages set the culture. Then every interaction after reinforced the culture. All employees work physically every day. The goal is 100% of staff directly works on the product. We all had ergonomics and safety training, then installed the digital self-management apps, DSM, on whatever phone we brought in with us. Then we got our security badges and safety shoes. That was it, 4 hours, and into work the next day. The anti-handbook handbook has 16 topics, and I've created a retrospective type around it to help companies move their onboarding process towards this. But I'll not do the retrospective now. Instead, I'll say what the enforced culture is. The anti-handbook handbook says in 16 items in 4 pages, Musk companies have high standards. If you're the type of person that waits for feedback from your manager to know if you did a good job, you probably won't fit in a Musk company. The handbook says, we don't mean to sound harsh, that's just honest. The handbook says, you will need every day to be in the factory, whether you're writing software or whether you're attempting to make leadership decisions, or if you're operating the Agile program like I was, you will need to be in the factory. And it's your job to go wherever the bottleneck may be and try to improve it. You have to hold yourself to your own high standards. As a result of that, they enforce a high trust environment. The handbook says, it's assumed that you are a good person and that everyone else in the company is a good person. Some people have violated that trust. However, they won't stop trusting people just because of a few bad people. Instead, those bad people are eliminated and they attempt to keep a high trust culture across all 110,000 employees now and 500 suppliers. Topic three, communication. The handbook says you're not going to get any. The handbook actually talks about managers and departments. Strangely, in Tesla, there aren't managers or departments, even though the handbook says you can talk to your manager, you can talk to your manager's manager, you can talk to your manager in another department, you can talk to Elon. You're told when you're first hired, anyone can talk to Elon. And Elon added to that, if anyone tries to stop you from talking to Elon, they will be fired immediately. This enforces the culture is flat. Now, related to that, Elon is in the factory. Elon is in either SpaceX or Tesla 12 hours a day, working, physically working, building cars, programming robots, writing Python code, unloading trucks. So you can go talk to Elon. The handbook says you cannot wait for communication. Most of the time, you are going to need to act on your own and self-organize a group or a mob to address the issues as you find them. There's no manager allocating you. You self-allocate. To reinforce that, the next point is job duties. Job duties are whatever is important to do. So job duties include lifting 20 kilograms into robots, unloading robots, getting robots unstuck, unloading trucks, painting cars, inserting wires into cars. Your job duties, no matter what job you thought you were going to do when you're hired, is whatever is the bottleneck. For example, when I was hired into Tesla, the primary bottleneck was paint, specifically the North Paint building, and primarily red paint, but actually some other colors too. So I spent a lot of time in coding and became very skillful in coding, despite that at the same time, I was updating the artificial intelligence for definition of ready and definition of done as part of the Agile practice. The next point is goals and feedback. The handbook says you're not going to have any. There are no performance reviews. There's no manager to say you're doing a good job or not. You are going to need to assess yourself and coach yourself to continuously improve. Next is safety. Safety is uncompromisable. If you accidentally do something unsafe, you will be supported, coached, lovingly corrected, even if you do that a few times. But if you intentionally do something unsafe, you will very likely be fired immediately. Attendance, tardiness, and sick days. It's okay to be late. They get it. Traffic gets bad. Sometimes the car doesn't start, whatever the issue, the train's late. It's okay to be late. Make sure you communicate with your team so that they're not waiting for you. It's awesome to take vacation. That's why you have it. Take your vacation. But if you ever don't call and don't show up, so your team is waiting on you, your whole team or the entire mob that you were likely to join that day has lost time. That is unforgivable. You better have a really good reason. If you don't have an awesomely good reason for not calling and not showing up and delaying an entire team, you'll be fired. Outside employment is specifically allowed. You are specifically allowed to work for another company. You can even work for a competitor. Some of you may remember a few years ago, Tesla open sourced many of their patents, saying all our patents are belong to you. They said the goal is not for Tesla to make so many electric cars, it's for there to be so many electric cars. If Volvo does that, if Mercedes-Benz does that, if Toyota does that, if Ford does that, if Stellantis does that, if Seat or Skoda does that, or Renault, that's awesome. It doesn't have to be Tesla. So Tesla is a very open culture. They're trying to accelerate all companies. Now, most companies aren't willing to work the way Tesla does, the level of radical empowerment of the employees and self-organization. Because of that, Tesla still continues to have the highest range, highest efficiency, highest sales growth of their electric portfolio, for example. Stupid stuff. The handbook says, we're not going to list stupid stuff. You need to figure that out on your own. If you do stupid stuff, you might be fired immediately. Once could be enough. You are trusted, and you're trusted to give yourself high standards and operate without communication and do whatever job duty is required to advance the mission. If you do stupid stuff, we can't tolerate having you in the company. Next, fun. If there's anything you can do to increase your level of fun at work that doesn't slow you down or add risk, do it immediately. In SpaceX, the employees built a bar, and not just any alcohol serving bar, a tiki bar with wood carved Polynesian masks and everything, on top of the launch tower for Starship, the largest rocket in the world. This is the type of playful company culture that is absolutely true. Some of you saw online or maybe attended in person the opening of Gigafactory Brandenburg or Giga Berlin. It was a rave party with lasers, smoke, 10 meter tall Mylar dancing puppets. It's not that different inside the factories. Tesla really is a lot like a great big party all day long. It's incredibly intense. It's also super fun. The moral of the story is, you need to act autonomously to do whatever needs to be done next. The anti-handbook handbook doesn't talk much about group or mob, but I'll say now how it actually works is you self-organize into groups or mobs. There's almost no solo work. Solo work is allowed, it's just not done. Resolving concerns, there are two human resources or agile people operations departments. You can text them. That's the most common way, just using iMessage. You can email them, and you can walk up and talk to them in person. The vast majority of the communication in Musk companies is iMessage. If people have an Android, they use Signal, the encrypted Signal app. It's almost all chat. Many Tesla employees don't know what their email address is. Email takes you out of context. When you're programming, you have to switch context into reading email. Or if you're assembling robots or loading materials into robots, you have to switch context to check email. Whereas a message on your phone, an iMessage, is so short, it has less impact on context switching. And Musk says, context switching is the mind killer. As a result, the vast majority of communication at every area in Musk companies is iMessage or Signal. I'd like to say how fast Tesla is. Automotive companies, all of them except Tesla, work on what's called a minor model change cycle and a major model change cycle. The minor model change is every 2.5 years. The front bumper, the plastic shape might be changed. The software on the navigation might be changed. The door handles might change from silver to black. That would be a minor model change. And every 5 to 7 years, depending on the model, you have an almost entirely new design. This is the result of waterfall planning. Tesla has about the same level of change as a minor model change every day. This is completely unheard of in the world's auto industries. For example, the headlights, taillights, and charge port on the Model S and Model X changed in 2 days, including the embedded software that runs in the charge port and configures and controls the headlights and taillights. I have never seen a company this fast, ever. And when I hear companies talk about quarterly planning, quarterly big room planning, they're just not even on the same planet as a company like Tesla that makes 60 part changes a day. There are 60 new parts introduced in production and sold to customers every day. To manage complexity, 61 parts or more are removed every day. The total part count continues to go down. The Model 3 and Model Y are about 7,000 parts now, and that continues to reduce. The goal is to have fewer lines of code and fewer parts on the car. The way that's accomplished is refactoring, having a fast pace of new part introduction and a fast pace of new part deletion. In the job descriptions for Tesla and SpaceX, every single job description says part of your responsibility is to make new manufacturing processes and delete or eliminate manufacturing processes. The focus is on manufacturing. Most companies have a building to write software and a building to make decisions and another building to build stuff, a factory. In Tesla, there's just the factory. All work is done in the factory, including software development. That means if the most important thing to do is to unload a truck, the software developers, everyone will do that. Everyone works on everything to the extent they can. It doesn't mean everyone's perfect at everything, but everyone helps. As a result, Tesla is the fastest innovating company on planet Earth, and SpaceX is the fastest innovating company beyond Earth. I'd like to show you some sprints, some parallel executing sprints from SpaceX. Here are the parallel executing modules of Starship. Because of known stable interfaces at the top and bottom of Booster, Starship and Booster, or first and second stage, can be developed at completely different rates, completely different speeds. Booster, in this image, is on version 4. Booster now is on version 7. This image is old. Starship is on Starship 24. This image is old. But notice how much faster Starship is iterating than Booster. Now, Starship and Booster both consume Raptor engines. Raptor engines are designed and built on a two-day cycle, and no two of them are the same, ever. They're always innovations to try to be lighter, faster, higher thrust. And as long as the interface mates, Raptor engines attach to both Booster and Starship. They're completely separate work streams. This is part of their modularity. Then I'd like to show you some sprints from SpaceX. You can see some of the earlier sprints are 2 years long as the company was figuring out how to create rockets. And they get as short as 1 year, shorter. SpaceX is now on 2 day sprints. They can design, build, test fire, and install on the rocket a new Raptor engine in 2 days. The entire rocket still takes longer, about 2 weeks. Starship takes about a month. To manage complexity, SpaceX has one rocket family. They're retiring the Falcon system and moving entirely to Starship. So there's really just one product. Most companies sell their product. In aerospace, companies sell a rocket and they make just one with a waterfall. SpaceX iterates their rockets continuously, making them themselves much faster than any customer originally had wanted them. Now customers are lined up. The rockets have a lower and lower cost into low Earth orbit every week. Tesla or SpaceX then sells rides on the rocket in terms of kilograms to low Earth orbit. So it's like selling taxi rides and SpaceX builds the taxi, whereas all other aerospace companies build a taxi for you for one ride. So of course the price difference is completely different. What I'd also like to point out with this picture is here is the beginning of SpaceX Boca Chica. It's a huge city now, but it started with a tent and a dirt floor, and they were already building rockets. The focus is on the product. It's definitely not a bunch of people wearing suits standing around a really nice coffee bar deciding what they should command everyone to do next. There's none of that. There really is no hierarchy. The company is essentially flat. Everyone just works. So you are welding, you are cutting metal, you are ordering metal, and you're working in the beginning in the desert in a tent with a dirt floor. Then it grew into a city of tents and a much larger city of tents. And the factory is the product. So beautiful aesthetics are added iteratively. Designers, UI, UX are mixed in with everyone. And they also, their responsibility is to do everything, build cars if they can, write software, etc. They make beautiful signs that light up. It actually lights up in order. S-T-A-R-B-A-S-E. And it lights up every evening this way. It's actually extremely beautiful. And it's very modern and sharp looking. So even though it begins in a very unfashionable looking way, beauty is refactored in continuously, and it continuously becomes a nicer and nicer place to work. In terms of the factory itself, here is Giga Texas, which I attended the opening. Here is the land for Giga Texas, the day the land was bought. The day the land was bought, the land was cleared and leveled. 90 days later, there were operating factory elements. These are modules. These are repeating factory modules. They're being kitted here. Some are being delivered assembled. They have their own solar panels on top, their own power, and their own plumbing. If you zoom in, they were already casting cars. They were already building car parts. They were in production when the factory still didn't have all its walls. As soon as a module is installed, it's in production. So they learn what works, what doesn't, how to improve it. Now, this factory is fully done. It's in operation. It's shipping cars now. Next up, budgeting. Waterfall companies, as I will define it, have a year or longer budget. The challenge with a year or longer budget is things like General Motors commits to new Canadian battery materials plant for Ultium platform. And I replied to that news item. Waterfall companies announce funding releases years in advance. This locks up funding, requiring delegation and politicking over months to adapt financial commitments to changing environments like the ongoing chip shortage. Porsche. Porsche taken production temporarily halted over the Ukraine crisis. I replied, the war in Ukraine was not predicted in the 9-year budget for the Volkswagen Group. And it's not any better in Japan. Honda, Sony agree to electric vehicle development partnership, first deliveries in 2025. What happened is there's leadership teams that are not engineers anymore, and all they do is allocate budget and assign a date. This creates maximum stress on the engineers. Tesla doesn't do these practices at all. Here's what traditional budgeting looks like. A budget is allocated for a year or more. There's a plan. In a lot of companies, it's yearly planning. At least Scaled Agile Framework brings it to quarterly planning. Then the plan is analyzed, built, tested, and deployed. What the Musk companies are doing is having parallel executing work streams in about 2-day chunks. Some of them are as short as 3 hours, going through all these cycles. And I'll attempt to show some examples of that. Now, Waterfall actually has some awesome advantages. Most, but not all, most governments work on multi-year budget allocation cycles. If you have a year or longer budget allocation cycle, it's easier for you to get money from the government. The government understands what you're likely to be building over the next several years and can allocate money towards it. Also, if you have people near retirement, and say they're 2 years away from retirement and the budget is 2 years long, they can relax knowing what they're likely to work on for the next 2 years as they finish their career. These are very good things. These are awesome things about Waterfall. What Waterfall or larger than 1 year budgets is not good at doing is innovating. It's actually very poor at innovating. The first step for many existing Waterfall companies is to do Scaled Agile Framework and move to quarterly budgets, big room planning, quarterly planning. Some companies with big room planning still have a year-long budget or longer, but the goal is to move towards quarterly budgets. Then those companies typically move to Scrum, which has 30-day budgets or less. We call those sprints. And to do that, we introduce a product owner role to allocate the budget in 30-day or less cycles, and we call that list the product backlog. And Scrum is actually the least agile of the agile methods. It's just a mini waterfall. We have our big planning up front. We have our check progress meeting. We have our review at the end and our postmortem. That said, this is revolutionary for most companies. If they can get to a 30-day or less budget and release cycle, that is phenomenal. But 30-day or less budget cycles is way too slow for a company like Tesla. Tesla does not use product owners, scrum masters, product backlogs, sprint backlogs, retrospectives, any of these aspects anymore. What Tesla does is closer to Agile, which would be flexible budgets from a couple of weeks to a couple of months with a preference to the shorter timescale. What I learned working for Elon Musk is that budgets need to be allocated multiple times an hour or faster by an app. So Tesla has a software stack called AutoBidder. AutoBidder is trained on selling energy back to the power grids from Megapack, from the large battery systems. It's also trained on selling insurance premiums back and forth, Tesla insurance. This open market training for several years now has made AutoBidder incredibly accurate as an AI tool, as an artificial intelligence tool. What AutoBidder can do is help reallocate budget, actually now multiple times a second, and I'll show what that looks like. So there's no annual budget in Tesla. There's no weekly budget in Tesla. There's not even a daily budget in Tesla. Instead, there's real-time allocation of capital, which is called digital self-management. I'd like to take a moment here and talk about Elon Musk. Elon Musk actually sleeps in the factory, in a sleeping bag. Elon does not even own a house anymore. Elon works 12 or more hours every day, typically 16 hours, in Tesla or SpaceX building things. Not in meetings, not viewing presentations, building things in mobs with the engineers. So Elon joins the mobs, and for some of you who might not be familiar, in a mob you have one driver. In a group, it's usually five people or less. You have one driver who types or wrenches or does the work, and you have two, three, or four other people that cheer them on, give them advice, and coach them. They rotate who is the driver as often as the driver feels success. So that depends on the work type. It's usually about every 7 minutes, but some work you don't feel success for an hour. So you'd rotate the driver once an hour. That can happen. Sometimes it's as fast as 3 minutes. You want the driver to feel success before you rotate. So everyone's going to be driver. If the driver is new, as long as one person in the mob can coach them and give them advice on what to try next, the mob can move forward. At the end of one mob, you've created radical cross-training, radical cross-skilling. Elon Musk is famous for being deeply knowledgeable on rocket building, battery technology, automotive manufacturing, artificial intelligence, embedded processing in the human brain, and more. Well, and currency with Dogecoin, and before that, PayPal. Elon joins the mobs for 12 or more hours every day. That's it. I actually don't think Elon is necessarily a genius. Elon may be a rare brain. Elon actually may be. But there are many people with tremendous levels of cross-functional knowledge in the Musk companies. And I think many of them are not above average. Some of them may be significantly below average intelligence. By joining the mobs every day, they learn phenomenally different skill sets day after day after day. So what Elon does is Elon joins the mobs. He tries to find wherever the bottleneck is, goes there, joins the mob, and you know where the bottleneck is because you see Elon's sleeping bag. When Elon gets sleepy, Elon gets into his sleeping bag and goes to sleep. When Elon wakes up, Elon tries to determine, is this still the bottleneck? And if so, Elon joins the mob again. If not, Elon goes to where the new bottleneck and joins that. So Elon will be getting an elevator unjammed or making sets of engineering decisions for a rocket, for the gas tanks inside the rocket. But by that, I mean the pressure. What makes this parallel execution work so well is modules. Here is the actual modular diagram for the Tesla Plaid battery cooling system. You can see the inputs and outputs are labeled. This is what's important. The cooling system could change twice in a day. as long as the inputs and outputs remain constant, that new version of the battery cooling system will be compatible with all the rest of the car in production. It ends up looking like my team WikiSpeed did a long time ago, where you have teams for each module working in parallel. And they try to make a meaningful contribution in as short amount of time as they can. Sometimes it takes weeks. Sometimes it takes 1 hour. It depends on what a meaningful contribution might be for that group. And those are released into production whenever they're finished in real time. Now, this I actually learned from Bill Gates. When I was working with Bill, Bill started every single meeting by saying, "How much of this can we do in parallel?" And that really struck me every single meeting. How many parallel executable work streams are there that are not waiting on each other? Now, this does mean that each module team has their own software development, their own procurement, their own ability to execute without waiting, and known stable interfaces help that. Now, by the way, these interfaces can and do change anytime. However, an adapter is added for backwards compatibility for maintenance reasons. And this makes the teams really fast. Jeff Bezos insisted on teams of 5 people or less. Jeff Bezos noticed that teams of 6 people or more almost always chose to elect a leader, and that slowed the team down. They would wait on the leader to make decisions. So Jeff Bezos insisted the teams would be 5 people or less. That allowed them to innovate quickly in a flat structure without paying a separate leader that wasn't doing all the work and slowing everybody else down, waiting on the leader. This is also true in Tesla. The mobs are often starting with 50 or even more people, and then they split, they self-split into 5 people or less, or sometimes pairs, 2 people. And this may be the most novel aspect of Tesla of all. Digital self-management is a set of apps on your phone, and on monitors all around the facilities. What these apps do is answer questions for you that you would have asked a manager. So some people will say, could artificial intelligence really coach an employee to improve? Can artificial intelligence really allocate budget in a responsible, useful way? Can artificial intelligence really answer a question like, should I build this part this way or that way? Well, I'll say in some cases, yes. And the purpose of digital self-management is one at a time, take a frequently asked question that created a wait state, that created people waiting on something like a manager, and replace it with an app. If a company simply deleted all managers without introducing something like digital self-management, the company would fail. Digital self-management has allowed Tesla to essentially eliminate all management positions. I'd like to reintroduce the lean coffee tool the way Jim Benson introduced it in Seattle, Washington around 2008. I was in some of the very first lean coffees with Jim and with David Anderson, who later went on to write the book Kanban, and Corey Lattice, who wrote the book Scrumban. And I was really impressed with how lean coffee allowed an agenda to self-organize to be created. If you've played lean coffee, that's actually really similar to how work is self-organized at Tesla. Every day at 5 a.m. and again at 5 p.m., people walk into Tesla or SpaceX and they look at what the available projects are. They propose new projects and they self-organize around them. That's actually not too different from lean coffee. What it actually looks like is the Justice Board. At the top, you have the total company money, the bank account balance for Tesla or SpaceX. And then you have how much money is being spent a day or an hour. And the questions that are asked of all employees is, are we spending enough? And are we spending it efficiently? The efficiency metric is value divided by capital expenses plus operations expenses. Operations expenses are primarily salary. Capital expenses are primarily robot uses, or it's basically a cubic meter rental cost of using the factory. An important aspect is this is calculated for you. It's not perfect, but it's pretty good. Tesla AI looks all around the factory, and if it sees a group of five people, it adds up their salaries automatically, and that's OPEX, and then it measures approximately the cubic meters of the factory being used, and that's CapEx, and then it asks those people through text, what's your value formula? How do you measure value? Tesla's overall value is the number of days accelerating the advent of sustainable transport. That's Tesla's overall value. Now, each row on the justice board is a project, and some of these rows are huge, like Cybertruck. And some of these rows are smaller, like Autopilot. Autopilot has hardware and software, but it's smaller than the entire Cybertruck. And some of them are really small, like a robot to apply insulative tape inside the cars. That's also a row on the justice board. When you walk in every day to the company, you look at the justice board and you use the law of mobility, like an open space conference, to self-allocate to any of these projects where you think you could add the most value today. And that is your job. You are held accountable to that. Now, you don't have a manager, so you have to decide which is the best trade-off of you learning a new skill versus directly adding value. Now, for SpaceX, their primary value is cost per kilogram to low Earth orbit. And because of that, you might see the trend here. SpaceX is by far, by an order of magnitude, the lowest cost per kilogram into low Earth orbit. Actually, every other rocket system is an order of magnitude more expensive. In SpaceX, you might self-allocate to Starship or Raptor or Launch Tower. Here are some of the parallel executing modules that you might join: launch tower, launch mount, orbital launch mount, etc. Now, each of these rows has a trend, and the value formula changes over time. For example, Autopilot. The first value formula was, can the car drive 10 meters inside the factory and stop safely? That was step one. Step two, can the car drive itself through the car wash? Can the cars basically wash themselves before delivery? Step three, can the cars drive themselves onto the transport trucks? Then step four, the cars add the capability to put themselves through homologation and road legal testing. Now, this is key because if you're changing 60 parts a day, that means you have to re-homologate, recertify the entire car. That means every car is homologated and certified individually. That means the cars need to automatically test themselves and upload their own test results and ask for their individual certification, which they do. That's what they do. This is actually very similar to what most of us call DevOps. So the value formula changes, and the value formula for Autopilot now is percent safer than human. How that's calculated is per kilometer driving. How many times was there an accident? And if there was an accident, was Autopilot on within the last few minutes of the accident? Or was Autopilot not on during the last few minutes before the accident? And Tesla always deploys new innovation to customers near the factories first. So every time there's a new Autopilot hardware update or Autopilot software update, people living near the factories, so near Bradenburg, near Sparks, Nevada, near Austin, Texas, near Fremont, California, near Shanghai, they get the most updated hardware and software first. So if there's a recall, Tesla doesn't have to reach out so far to get it. That means the roads nearest the factories, Tesla has far and away the most data, the most information on how to drive those cars. What that does mean is on the roads near the factory, there is 3,200% less likelihood of an accident when Autopilot is engaged than a human is driving without Autopilot. So the Autopilot's team's current goal is to increase that percent safety factor more and more and more, and expand the number of square kilometers on the surface of the Earth that has that level of safety. So the point I'm trying to make here is the value formula changes over time. And it's always, the current value formula is always visible. Some of these parts that change in a day or less are made by suppliers. Bosch in Germany makes the steering rack and the brake master cylinder for the Tesla Model S. And they change that steering rack and they change that brake master cylinder every 1 week. I had the opportunity to meet the scrum master of the steering rack team. And they said, this is a very new way of working for Bosch. We have some agile divisions for Tesla, only for Tesla. And what we do is we have a long contract with Tesla, multiple years long. But inside that contract, it says we need to deliver updated parts in volume, not prototypes, but actual production parts in volume every 1 week. So every 1 week, the steering rack needs to get lighter, cheaper, better, more responsive, better steering feel. Same with the brake master cylinder. And they do. Even a company with a very long history as a traditional waterfall company, parts of Bosch are able to do that. The giga castings are made by a set of suppliers. And these castings change every 45 minutes by a supplier. Suppliers deliver new die sets and stamp sets every 45 minutes working inside the Tesla factory. I had a chance to work with them. They're a phenomenal group. Now, how do you, in most companies, if you deploy a new design to production, your production teams don't want it. They need to set up the manufacturing facility and capabilities and testing infrastructure for your new design. They would not want a new design in production every day. They would not want a new design in production even every year. So how do you have production be ready for a new design multiple times a day? In some cases, multiple times an hour. That's what's called extreme manufacturing. Extreme manufacturing has a set of 11 principles. Each is made to fix a cause of long-running hardware operations. One of them is contract first design, then iterate the design. I wrote a book that goes into detail behind each of these principles and how to apply them. It's called Scrum Master. It's published in English, Spanish, Japanese, French. The German version is almost done, they keep telling me, but it's been almost done for a few months. So we'll see. I hope it finishes very soon. If any of you would like to help proofread and get it over the final bottleneck, I would love the help. Please tweet to me at Joe Justice. And finally, I would close the course playing open space, where teams practice self-organizing and self-reallocating using the law of mobility, just like Tesla does. Now, Tesla doesn't run open space to talk. They run open space to build stuff. But in the class, what we can do is review people's questions and map to their specific work environment how they would solve these problems. We actually use open space around lean coffee sessions. That's how big a fan I am of lean coffee. I'm really impressed by what Jim Benson created with that platform. So these open space groups propose agenda items that become lean coffee topics and then join lean coffee rooms to work through their issues. The directly relating to Tesla part is that in Tesla, you self-organize, self-allocate, and reassign using the law of mobility. In most companies, that's unheard of. A manager tells you what to do, and your job title tells you what you're allowed to do and what's outside your scope. Practicing open space is the closest I've ever seen to how Tesla actually works inside. If you took a hardware company now or software company and every day at the start of the shift hosted an open space on the running projects and people self-allocated and could use the law of mobility to reallocate at any time, that would be really close already to how Tesla operates. Then if you over time started developing a digital self-management suite, you could start to replace management, which would get much closer to what enables Tesla speed of iteration. Folks, it's my honor to talk about how Tesla launches teams to create their culture, creates a fast company, budgets in real time, splits parallel executable modules, has fast teams of five people or less using Mob, uses digital self-management to create a flat company with the goal of 100% of staff directly working on the product. And why I like Lean Coffee, even though I didn't host Lean Coffee inside Tesla, how the Justice Board works to self-allocate, like the agenda of an open space, how a contract can be multiple years long, but it can specify the product or delivered good is updated on a cadence. I mentioned extreme manufacturing for the shop floor to keep pace with design, and why I think open space technology is so relevant. I'd love to find out if there's comments or questions, and thank you very, very much.